I want to say first that we're bringing your attention to this little slip of paper. If you didn't get one, I don't know, they're over here, or maybe they've been passed out. But they are about the sort of second phase of a pro-transit campaign that we mounted last week to get people to sign a petition saying, you know, let's build this stuff. We want these transit lines. We voted for them in 2003. Let's get this job done. So that's what this is about. You go online to at the bottom, it says petition.houstontomorrow.org. This will go on all summer. It just started Friday. We've got almost 900 signatures on it so far. And these things, people pay attention to these things. So we've got two or three petitions in the past where things changed as a result of them. So spread the word around, get people in your organizations to do this, and let's see if we can get this system going a little bit. When you hear today what we're going to do, and you sort of say, well, wait just a minute. You know, there's a system over here, and then there's a new system over here, and there's no connection between these systems. We need to fix that problem. So this is pretty exciting stuff. I mean, a long time ago, we wrote extensively about different kinds of systems, and we're actually very much pro bus rapid transit. And for a short time, you may remember, Metro changed, after the 2003 election, changed some of the light rail lines to be BRT. And some of the neighborhoods went ballistic and thought they would be getting the short end of some stick. So it all went back to red. So this is going to be our big experiment. I think it's an experiment, because of where it is, that is going to affect the whole region. And I'm sure Bob will tell you how that works. Once you start looking at the rest of the freeways and see, you can make this stuff go everywhere, it sounds like something new to think about for our region. So, Bob Ethington, you are, as I recall, strategic planner
economic development research.
Yeah. So thanks for coming.
Thank you.
Just tell us what you're going to do.
All right, David, thank you. I appreciate the invitation to be here and appreciate you guys being here to see what's going on in Uptown and some of the latest that we have on the BRT system, the Bus Rapid Transit System, or DBL, what we call DBL, the Dedicated Bus Lane System. Keeps it from being too confusing with light rail, as some people hear one as opposed to the other, or they merge the two. So, what I would like to do today is I'd like to take just a few minutes to show you what's going on in the Uptown areas as far as all the new development, et cetera, et cetera. And then I'm going to share with you the presentation that Andy Aitken gave at the town hall meeting Monday evening at the Hilton in Uptown to over 200 people that attended that meeting. In fact, how many of you were at the meeting? Okay, so several were there. And we had over 200 people there at the meeting. It was a lively meeting. And appreciate all of you that showed up to that meeting. Hopefully, if you did not have your question answered at the meeting, we have those questions. We're working on the answers, and we're going to give both the question and the answers on our website so that you can have the answer to your question. It's just impossible to get through all the questions in the amount of time that we have. So, we like to show this because our director of marketing communication, David Miswald, was watching a Monday Night Football when it came into Houston, and you know how when Major League Football comes into Houston, they like to take kind of an iconic shot that makes people see the beauty of the area that they're in. And so when they're in San Francisco, they'll take the Golden Gate Bridge. When they're in Cleveland, they'll take, I'm not even sure what they're showing Cleveland. But when they came into Houston, no offense to my friends from Cleveland, but when they came into Houston, we loved it that at least one of those iconic shots that they wanted to show for Houston was of the Uptown area and some of the branding that we brought into the area over the past several years. As we look, I'm a little hesitant to share with you some of this stuff because it could be things that you already know. And so if it is, bear with me. Maybe we'll get to some of the things that you're not aware of as of now. But when we look at the new development that's in the area, both retail, hotel, residential, and office, it's kind of mind-blowing and staggering. And obviously not just in the Uptown Houston area, but when you look at the Houston region itself, there are areas that are just incredibly busy right now with development. If you take just our area in and of itself, going all the way up almost to Woodway, you begin with the Greystone Group building their mid-rise residential, Georgia Borlini with the Belfiore for sale. condominiums. The BHP builds an office, 600,000 square foot, being built right here. And by the way, just to orient you, of course, this is the 610 loop, the west loop, and this here is Post Oak Boulevard, right on the back of David, right there. And then here's San Felipe, here's Westheimer, right here. So as we continue moving down, you've got the BHP Billiton office, Hanover's building there, residential right here. Ed Walsh getting ready to complete his Boulevard place. I'm told, it's not a promise, but I'm told Whole Foods is going to be opening up in August. And I am incredibly excited about that because we office right here. And I'm going to go out on this beautiful boulevard, and I'm going to walk right there to Whole Foods and buy good stuff. So, Whole Foods is coming in. Apache, we'll look at all these in just a minute. Apache owns approximately six acres right here on the south end of Ed Wilson Boulevard Place. Continue moving down, Dennis Nelson and his team are looking at a smaller office tower here in the St. James area. You've got Redstone with the DBA Compass building that's up, Stream Realty. Are also looking at another office tower, and they're also looking at kind of a mixed-use retail, hotel, residential in the area. Amley completed, they're on McHugh, their residential tower, White Co. 250. Continue moving on, Gallery is going through renovation. I'll go into this a little bit more. Hyatt Regency is being developed right now and built. Hines finished their first residential product for Houston here at the Waterwall Place. Broadstone, Post Oak are just now starting to open up. Avenue R over here on Richmond. You go just inside the loop, you got Soul Uptowns ready to go. Gables Post Oak was opened up the latter part of last year. MG Bank is taking the new micro, or the old Micro Center site. The Micro Center is actually going to move down here in the southwest side of the 1655 interchange. Skyhouse Residential has their cranes up, and they're rocking and rolling on it. River Oaks District, seen it, it's going to be beautiful. Millennium High Street's already open. 3009, that was the Skanska building that was sold to the Lyant Group. And then Post, this actually is a little bit confusing. It says Post 510, that's actually downtown, but this is a new Post product where the old Holiday Inn was, and I was just on the phone with them actually a couple days ago. They say, at least right now, it's going to be called Post Galleria. It's going to be another mid-rise, high-end, luxury four-lease residential. So we got a lot of stuff going on here. And if you broaden this out even a little bit further, and you take in what's going on in Westland with PMRG's 40 Tower, when you look at about a mile and a half radius around the uptown area, you have as much multifamily residential being built at this time as any other mile and a half radius in the United States. There's a lot of construction going on in this area. Retail development, when people think of uptown, they typically think of retail, right? In fact, I remember one time asking, you know, when I say the word uptown, what's the first thing that comes to mind? And the first word that came out of one lady's mind was shoes. At least I thought it was shoes. And I said, really, shoes? She goes, no, I didn't say shoes. I said, sushi. So it doesn't matter either way, because that's what people think of when they think of the uptown area, the Galleria area. They see it as a very nice high-end retail development area. And there's a reason for that. You know that as retail follows rooftop, high-end retail follows high-end rooftops. And so when you do demographic studies, you can look at per capita income, you can look at average household income, and you can compare them to some of these other areas that are very, very nice areas in the United States, Highland Park up north in that little town up there. You've got Beverly Hills, you've got South Coast, Buckhead over in Atlanta. We actually have a higher per capita or higher average household income in a 3 mile radius than any of those areas. So you've got the means to be able to support the high-end retail that's in the uptown area. Boulevard Place and Book, as I said a minute ago, that's opening up. It's really beginning to look beautiful. Frost Banks is coming in there, True Food Kitchen, other retail, a little over 200,000 square feet. You know about the renovation of the Galleria. They're demoing the west side of the Galleria. They're going to move the Saks Fifth Avenue out. They're going to move it all the way out here. It's not showing it there. But what they're trying to do, what Simon's trying to do, is create two true anchors. You know how you used to go from the east side, walk through the Galleria, and then you stop at the Saks, not realizing that you actually had to walk through the Saks to get to the Galleria 3. And then in Gallery 3, there were the smaller little retail shops that were having a very difficult time staying in because it seemed like all the traffic stopped. And so what they're doing is they're demoing that whole space. They're going to build a whole new area for Saks Fifth Avenue. They're going to move it out to the end, make it a true anchor. And then those smaller retail shops, they're going to redevelop and redesign this interior space here and move them in to this space. They're also taking the Macy's that's just south, and they're demoing it. It's going to become part parking, and they're not sure exactly what, but the word that we get right now is the possibility of a high-end residential that's actually attached to the Galleria. So we'll see if that comes. Fall 2015 completion is what they're targeting. River Oaks District, you know about, beautiful area. It's actually not in our actual boundaries or our district, but it's in our market area. It's just inside the loop. They're on Westheimer, Oliver McMillan. Beautiful product. I don't know if you've been by, but y'all go by and see it. It's really very, very nice. He's got a lot of mixed use going on there with office, residential. He's got a really cool theater coming in there, too. It's a very nice high-end theater. Y'all have to check it out while type this. Hotel development is starting to come back into the area. We have pretty much about an 80% occupancy of hotels in the Uptown Houston area. And the experts tell me, and I'm sure there's some fudging in this, but they say once you hit about 65%, you need to start looking at the possibility of new development. We know that we have a variety of hotels looking into our area. What a lot of people don't realize is this, and I just did these numbers from the comptroller's office of the state of Texas. When we look at the Uptown area, when we look at the Greens Point area with the airport, when we look at the medical center, when we look at downtown, last year, the revenue generated by the hotels in each one of those four core areas for hotels in Houston, we had almost $300 million that we were generating in revenue. And Greens Point Medical Center and Central Business, as you can see, were right around mid-150s. Now that's going to change for the Central Business District, CBD, because they've got some great product coming in there, so that will go up. I don't know if it's going to reach the 300 threshold. Uptown seems to be, and has been historically, the hotel place to be. You can get a place in Uptown, it's a nice area to be in because it also has all the extra amenities that you're looking for. In fact, we had the federal government come in about, I guess it's been about a month now. Look at some of the items that deal with the federal grant that we received from HGAC, and they came in, the first words out of their mouth was, we had to stay in the Hobby airport area. Why don't you guys have hotel rooms here? And we tried to tell them, you know what? We do. They just were taken. They were occupied. So that's Uptown. Hyatt Regency is being built right now. It's beautiful product. It's great to have them there. That's going to be just on the west side of the Galleria. So you're there at about Sage and the West Alabama, as it says, just on the west side across the street from the west end of the Galleria. They got about a late 2015 completion. We have other hotels looking at the area, just like they're looking in other areas, Houston, the W's, the Ritz-Carlton's, some of the nicer higher-end hotels. And we'll see if we're fortunate enough to get one of those. You've got the residential developments coming in. As I said, we've got tons of residential development that is coming in at this time. And what we're finding is it's obviously that density is increasing because you're getting closer to the urban core. You've got four-lease product, which is very, very strong. But now we're having the for-sale product come back. Georgia Borlingi, Randall Davis built the first two for-sale units in that area in a long, long time. And they haven't even completed their projects. But both projects are at least 80% sold already. So they feel very confident about the for-sale product in our area. And I'm hoping some more will come in. When I looked at it, about an 18-month period of residential units that have been delivered or are being developed right now or are projected, not as a possibility, but as a probability, I'm looking at about 7,000 units within the Uptown market area. It's going to be delivered within about an 18-month period. That's a lot of units. Hanover Post Oaks, beautiful. It's right there next to where we're at, Post Oak Central. 29-story tower, getting about 350 units. You've got Sky House. It's being built just inside the loop next to Target. They have another product they're building downtown. Looks just like this. Gables Tanglewood, we actually went there with the Bel Air City Council, the mayor and the ex-mayor, and just a few days ago. We kind of had a tour of various products that are out there that are available. We went there. I will tell you, that was the first time I'd been to the Gables Tanglewood. I've been to other residential products in the Uptown area, but I hadn't been to this one yet. And that's a nice product. I will just tell you right now. Very, very nice. Water Wall Place, Heinz always builds high-end quality. They're there right by the water wall. That was their first residential in the city of Houston, as I said. You've got Belfiore. This is Giorgio Borlini's unit. He comes in, you know, and he jokingly says, you know, I don't think there's 47 people that will buy my units, but I think there are 46. So I'm going to develop a 46-unit tower. And he's there on Post Oak Lane, South Post Oak Lane and South Winden. These units, there are none that are smaller than 4,600 square feet. They're going to go for at least $600 a square foot for the concrete. We had an individual come in just the other day, buy up an entire floor, so over 9,000 square feet, spent almost $6 million on it, and that was just to the whites, and then he's going to have to build the thing out. So, and right now, Giorgio, he's at about 80% sold in this. So there's a great market for this right now. The Astoria, this is Randall Davis's. His is already being constructed. He's probably about, I don't know, four, six or seven now. It's right by the McDonald's there off of Post Oak Boulevard. It's going to be hopefully finished by about first quarter of 2015. 74 custom luxury units. Same kind of deal here. There are some people coming in here buying up an entire floor. Some are just buying the units, but some are buying an entire floor. That's unusual, but it does show that there is a demand. Office development, as you know, in the area, Skanska built this building, 3009. It's there on the south end of Post Oak near Richmond. Very beautiful, platinum building. BBVA Compass was the first office tower built in the area for 30 years. The last one that was built was the Williams Tower in 1983. And this one came in 30 years later, 2013. So it's gold certified, another great building. BHP Billiton is building there at the Four Oaks area. They're building a 600,000 square foot tower. They are going to have, they're already occupying one of the towers. They're going to occupy this tower. They're going to have a little over 2,000 employees there in that area. BHP, when the president of BHP America came in and met with us, he said he wants to build a product that is so beautiful that it can become a signature product because he's tired of people thinking that he's BP. Because nobody knows, he says, nobody knows who BHP is. Well, BHP is the largest mining company in the world. In the world. And they're going to have their global headquarters for the petroleum division here in the Uptown area. There is no company in America that has the economic impact on the economy, the national economy, that BHP does on their country's economy. So it's like, you know, as BHP goes, so goes the Australian economy. They have that big of an impact. BHP is a big, big player. Apache is looking at that 6-acre site. Are they going to build? We don't know. But this has been in design for quite a while. They're working with Heinz. They're looking at about a 750,000 square foot tower. Beautiful, and of course we'd love to have them build this new product. Amogee Bank is going where the old micro center used to be, just inside the loop. So that kind of gives you an idea and a feel for what's going on. Now, as you know, with all the development that's going on, guess what comes with that? Yeah, the T word. We have traffic. We've had mobility issues there for a while. And, you know, we're thinking, how is it that we can deal with and take care of those mobility issues? Well, one thing that we look at when we look at our area is that this area is a true mixed-use urban area. It really is. It's not dominated by one particular type of product. You got about 40% of our value coming from office, about 30% coming from residential, about 20% coming from retail, and about 10% coming from the hotels. And the land shows 2%, and I know some of you math people are going to add that up, and you're going to say, wait a minute, that's 102%. Mm-hmm. And the answer is yes, that's the way we do everything. We just do it 102%. Actually, that land is about to go away. The 6-acre site that's on the northwest corner of Richmond and Post Oak has been sold. We've got very, very, very little undeveloped land in the uptown area now that is for sale. Everything's going to have to be redeveloped. So you look at that and you say, well, there's a great mixed use there, and so there's going to be lots of a variety types of traffic that comes into the area. So how do we deal with this? What do we do? What can we do? There's been a variety of options that have been discussed and looked at, but before we talk about that, we looked at where do our workers live. That's what we wanted to deal with. We have 80,000 workers in the area. The peak hours, the peak morning, evening, and lunchtime hours are where the worst traffic is, of course, when the worst traffic is. So what do we do with this? And so when we did our surveys, and they're incredibly statistically validated, but in these surveys, most of our workers were coming from the northwest, west, southwest side. And of course, the closer you get to the uptown area, the red is where the uptown area is. That's where our number of employees, we have more employees living in that area than any of the other areas, but still you have major amounts of employees coming from this corridor. So how do we help move those people in and out of our area in a way that's comfortable, consistent, reliable, and hopefully stress less transit? We looked at what Metro was doing and their park and ride corridors, and they were coming from those same pipelines from the northwest, west, southwest side, and even, of course, along the West Park. And we looked at them, and we looked at the number of buses they were having, and they were sending straight to downtown. So as you can see on the chart with the number of buses that they have in the AM and PM trips, moving people into the downtown area, they were doing a tremendous job of moving these people into the area, putting them on these buses, sticking them on these HOV lanes, and allowing them to move into the area at express rate, coming in downtown. The problem that we had with that was, out of those 300 plus buses coming from these corridors, that doesn't include the other corridors that Metro's pulling people into downtown, but coming from the corridors where most of our employees live, coming from those corridors, we were getting 10. And those 10 buses were only coming from the northwest and west corridor. We were getting zero from the southwest corridor. And this actually, even though it was 10 buses, it was only two spots, one coming from Katy and one coming from up north. And so you've got 10 buses, two routes, servicing an area that is the second largest employment center in Houston. Now, we kind of jockey back and forth with the medical center, but when you look at the International Downtown Association, the work that they just did, looking at a variety of metropolitan cities, and then the little micro cities within those cities, they came back and told us the same thing that we our numbers showed us, and that is that we actually have more workers in our area than in the Texas Medical Center. So downtown obviously is number one, but uptown is number two, medical center is number three, and we are, can I say, the least service transit area? So, what do we do, and how do we do this without disrupting too much and without it costing too much? Would there be a way for us to imagine this as a river of people, or imagine this as an oil pipeline, tap into it, and move people into our area? And that was the proposal. The proposal was to take an existing transit center, the Northwest Transit Center, build a South Anchor Transit Center here on the south end somewhere, we weren't sure exactly where, and then move people in and out of our area in a way, thus kind of extending, this is almost like an extension of the HOV into our area. So, what do we do? And this kind of says the same thing. What you're looking at, the purple here, this is the 610 loop. And this, is, of course, is TxDOT territory. The orange is the Post Oak Boulevard, and that's in our district. That's a city street. And so what we looked at then, and then, of course, down here where the P is the South Transit Center, Transfer Center, that has not been built yet, that we are in discussion with Bel Air and and looking at building this Bel Air Uptown Transit Center. So, this was the idea. All these people coming in, can we reroute those people that want to move into our area and reroute them from already existing lanes into our area and meet them? That's where the bus rapid transit system came in. When we went to TxDOT to begin these discussions a long, long time ago, we were thinking something about, well, maybe we could put those candlesticks down in the center for that couple of miles that we would need to move buses on the 610 loop, keep them out of traffic so that they can maintain a reliable headway. And could we do that? We were trying to think of all different kinds of options, and TxDOT came back and said, what about this option? What if we took that median, left that shoulder open for the automobiles that need it, but then built a dedicated, elevated lane for this? And so that's what the discussion is now. TxDOT just last week, they committed $25 million to the project. Uptown has already committed $20 million to this portion of the project, so we now have $45 million to do an approximate 2 mile segment along the 610 loop in an elevated, dedicated lane. There's other options too that we're looking at, but that obviously would be the one that we think would be most appealing. Those buses then, when they come in from the Northwest Transit Center, they will come in, they'll never enter, if they go on to the 16 loop in that dedicated elevated bus lane, as they move in, they'll never interact with traffic. They will come in, they'll come up in the middle of the 16 loop, which in 2004, when it was redesigned, it actually has that space to do that. So they'll come up in the middle, they'll be on their elevated lane, they'll go down. By the way, this is the orientation now, this is north, this is south. And so they're coming down the middle, elevated lane, and then they drop down through the middle, still not interacting with the traffic that's on the 16 loop, down to grade, and then come on to Post Oak Boulevard in its own dedicated lane. So that's the discussion right now. This is why we're trying to do this. This was a picture that our president, John Breeden, by the way, he was not able to be here to do the presentation himself. He had another meeting he had to be at, and so you got, the backup. So he took this picture with his phone just out his office window one day and said, that's exactly what I'm talking about. This is the type of traffic that we need to try to mitigate and deal with. And so as you can see, you've got people trying to come out of these retail centers. You've got the metro buses that are riding on Post Oak Boulevard that, I mean, in all practicality, become kind of a roadblock. And so they kind of, in a way, make Post Oak Boulevard not a three-lane northbound and three-lane southbound, kind of make it a two-lane northbound and southbound when they're running on it. And so, but then they get caught up in the queue, and so their headways are messed with. And then you got people trying to make turns, and you got some guy right here, you see this guy?
He's still there.
3 years. 3 years. He just doesn't know what to do. We send people out to him, give him food. Want to make sure he's taken care of. Yeah, right. So this is the issue that we're trying to mitigate. We're trying to allow for people that work, live, stay, shop in the area. We're trying to give them the best quality of life experience as far as transit traffic is concerned, and this is what we think is the answer. When we look at Post Oak Boulevard, right now Post Oak Boulevard is about 120 feet wide. We're looking at widening it 16 feet, so there's going to be some right-of-way acquisition. We'll talk about that in a minute. But what we want to do is take those buses, rather than having them on curb, we're going to put them in the middle, dedicated lane, so they never have to interact with the traffic. Our number one rule for this was do no harm to the automobile. In our area, with the high-end retail, with everything that's going on, the residential that's being built and all that, we know how important the automobile is. And so we did not want to reduce the amount of automobile lanes that there were. So we're keeping three lanes of traffic, both north and southbound. But we're having to look at the increase in density. We're having to look at the amount of people that are increasing. How can we move them in a way, a sustainable way, a comfortable way, convenient way, and allow greater mobility? And that's why we looked at the BRT. As it says here, oh, by the way, in this rebuild, and we'll talk about the boulevard in a minute, but in the rebuild, we're going to widen these sidewalks 12 feet. In our capital improvement projects that we present to the city and then the council and the city approve, and then that's what we do, because as a TERS, we're an arm of the city. In our capital improvement projects that we presented, we have began and completed most of those, and we've stayed away from Post Oak Boulevard because we felt like there may be the opportunity to really do something special on this boulevard. So let's go ahead and do the capital improvement projects on the other streets that have been approved, deal with them. Last couple of years, we spent about $20 million with sidewalks all throughout the area, headlights all throughout the area. We want to create a very safe environment, a very comfortable, attractive environment for people to be drawn out into the street, give them a greater walkability feel. We love that. But we stay away from Post Oak until now. It's time. Post Oak has to be rebuilt. It's there. It's in the capital improvement project. It's got to be rebuilt. So the question is, when we rebuild it, are we going to rebuild it exactly the same way? Or are we going to try to do some future projections about what the needs are going to be in the next 5, 10, 20, 25 years, and see if we can't design this in a way that will help meet those future projections? That's what we did. So, 12-foot sidewalks, and again, we'll talk about the boulevard in just a minute. But it preserves the six existing automobile traffic lanes. We don't think that someone's going to hop on the BRT system to go buy their Cartier. We think that they're going to probably drive their own car, and that's the type of retail that's in the area. We're going to preserve all the signalized left-hand turn lanes. We're going to maintain the existing signal operations. In other words, there's not going to be a preemptive. Those buses that are on Post Oak Boulevard will not have preemptive authority to override the traffic signals. Okay? So, and then you're going to ask, well, how do you get the time savings? We'll show you here in a minute. We're going to add these dedicated bus lanes so that they never have to interact with the automobile. We're going to remove buses then. Because of that, we'll be able to remove the buses that now operate on Post Oak Boulevard from the general lanes. Take them out, make it a true three-lane northbound and three-lane southbound boulevard. And then, of course, as I said, we're going to enhance the pedestrian access. We really do want to create a great grand boulevard that has a magnetic energy that pulls people out onto the street. We want to be able to, we want to design it such a way that it encourages walkability in the area. Okay? And then, of course, so many people ask me when we discuss this stuff, what about the trees? What about the flowers? The beauty of the landscaping? I will tell you that my work with Uptown began with them hiring me on contract to do a historical research of land all the way back to Sovereign. Okay? So I took it back all the way. If you ever do any survey work and you see the William White survey, I'll tell you exactly everything you want to know about William White. Because I took it all the way back to William White. I spent, I don't know how many dusty days in the Harris County Archive Office and the Deed Record Office and the GLO Office in Austin, finding out all this stuff, taking it, and then creating the story that shows that this is a living, breathing area. You know, it really is a great, great area to be in. Well, part of that, the DNA of that area, is the landscape. And so you are not going to find anyone on the board that wants to reduce, minimize, or degrade the beauty and the landscape of the area. It's not going to happen. And so when we finish the boulevard, you're going to find almost three times as many live oak trees on the boulevard than you do now. It's going to be beautiful. Now, this will kind of give you an early rendition of what this was supposed to look like. Dedicated bus lanes, as you can see. And by the way, these buses are going to be highly branded buses, so you'll know that you hop on this bus, you're coming into the Uptown area. Beautiful buses, I'll tell you about here in a minute. You got the three lanes of traffic. You got the dedicated left-hand turn lanes still here. Beautiful intersections for pedestrian crossings. And even as you move through the area, creating a green space, pocket park type spaces with kiosks that enable people to have a place to sit, coffee, whatever, all up and down the boulevard. I'll share this with you. About a month ago, maybe it's been 2 months because, you know, time flies. I was giving a presentation to a particular club at the River Oaks Country Club. And afterwards, one of the gentlemen that was there came up to me and says, hey, I got somebody that I think would really like to talk to you about this. And I said, great, would love to. and it was a friend of his, and it was a man by the name of Alexander Darwin. Well, Alexander Darwin was a professor of architect at Yale University for many, many, many years, decades actually, and he's an adjunct now. He's worked with New York, with the Trade Center rebuild. He's done a lot of work, textbooks, he's written books, and he was getting ready to write another book. That's why I bring this up. He's writing a book about what it takes to make a great city. And he says, you know, it's going to have like a chapter on town halls. It's going to have a chapter on town squares. It's going to have a chapter on parks. It's going to have a chapter on boulevards. And he says, I've been watching Post Oak Boulevard for many, many, many years. And I want to come in and I want to walk this boulevard with you. And I said, come on, I'd love to. So we started on the south end at Richmond, and we walked Post Oak Boulevard all the way up to the north to the 610, stopped off at Starbucks, got us a cup of coffee. And along the way, of course, I'm explaining the development that's going on and what our hopes were for the area, et cetera, et cetera. And I asked him, I said, Professor Garvin, I said, why are you here? And he said, well, he said, in my opinion, and remember, this is his opinion, he said, in my opinion, Post Oak Boulevard is the most important boulevard in the United States at this time. And he says, I wanted to come here and see what's going on. I wanted to see what kind of development is happening. Because I've been watching this, he said, for like almost 30 years, which I found interesting. So, is he right? Well, you know, since I work for Uptown, I will tell you he's absolutely right. there's other people that would say he's not right, but even if he's not right, it is an important boulevard, and it can become a grand boulevard. It can become one of the grand boulevards in the United States, depending on how this works out, plays out. And the board that's directing this, the Uptown board, would love to see the quality of this boulevard be the same quality of the other aspects of Uptown. So, oh, that's just another close-up. So when you look at this, you see that we're continuing the three lanes of traffic both ways, continued dedicated left-hand turns. For the most part, every stop or station for the BRT is going to be what's called a far side stop. And so instead of stopping at the light and doing the loading and unloading of passengers, it's actually going to be a far side stop, take the bus shelter over to the other side of the intersection, and that's where the loading and unloading will take place. And so in this particular diagram, if you're heading south, obviously it's on the south end. If you're heading north, it's going to be over here on the north end past the intersection. We feel like that this is the way the traffic engineers, I'm not a traffic engineer, they're the experts, but they tell me that this is the best way to minimize the dwell times of loading and unloading people. By the way, these buses that we're discussing are articulated buses. They're not like the typical city bus that travels along a variety of streets. They're not going to have steps or stairs. It's going to be platform loading and unloading on these buses. There'll be two or three doors to these articulated buses that will help maximize the loading and unloading of passengers in a very comfortable, safe, timely manner. So this is some of the design work that the design teams from both New York, Denver, and Houston, as they've collaborated, have come together and given to us. And it's a shelter. Shading is incredibly important, as you know, if you're going to be standing out there, say, July 23rd in the heat. You're going to want as much shade as you can. You're going to want maybe some air movement. And the possibility, we don't know, is there a possible way in a very sustainable way to cool this area? We don't know. They're checking into it. We can say yes, we can say no. But what we're wanting to design is a great shaded area. I will just tell you that I've been in meetings where they actually discuss, if it's August, and I'm standing on the east side of Post Oak, and I'm at this spot, where do I need shade? Where's that sun hitting me? How can I make sure that I've at least got that dappled shade that those great live oaks are going to be able to give me? And so there really is that much detail that's being thought through about how to build this to make it a great grand boulevard. What you see here is about 14-inch curb. Again, the engineers and people at Metro and whatnot are working on that. Is it 13 and a half inch? Is it 14 inch? I don't know. But obviously what they're going to do is they're going to have that curb to where that bus can come up, and there can be platform loading and unloading. So if you're in a wheelchair, if you're with a baby stroller, you're not having to go up steps. You just, like a light rail, what you're doing is you're just walking on to this transit bus. And this kind of gives you an idea of what that is. There's a little bit too much space here for the platform, but they'll be able to get closer, I'm told, within 2 to 3 inches. If you've been to London and the tube, you know, the Mind the Gap.
Yep. Mm-hmm.
What we're looking for is someone with a great Texas accent that can say Mind the Gap, and we'll just put it right there. I'm kidding with that, okay? So, we're looking at this.
Y'all watch your step.
Y'all watch your step. That'd be perfect. Love that. Y'all have a good day and watch your step. So, this kind of gives you a concept or idea of what these buses are going to be like and the platform loading and unloading. To give you an idea, at night, we want these to be obviously well lit. We want them to be safe, people to feel safe to be there, and the beauty of them. We want it to be beautiful. We're looking at these, we're doing some value engineering right now on these light sticks. Have you ever been in the area during the holiday time and those holiday trees that line the boulevard? You know that the beauty of those lights, kind of that regimented feel as you go up and down the boulevard? They're about 80 feet apart, and what we're looking at is taking these and making them approximately 80 feet apart, try to recreate that same feel only for the whole year that you're there. And these are self-illuminated. They're illuminated within, so they kind of glow, kind of like a glow stick. If this is the final design, they're still working on that. But then, of course, you have down lighting for the pedestrians there on the 12-foot sidewalks. But you also have up lighting. It's going to be up lighting those beautiful canopy of live oaks. They're going to be going not just along the sidewalks on the boulevard, but there in the middle of the boulevard. There's going to be a canopy that the design of these trees, and the board is going to be voting a week from Friday when they meet again, about some trees that we've looked at in Florida that actually came from, and I'm not an expert in that either, but basically these trees came from the same mother tree, so they have the same look, feel. They've been groomed so that by the time we plant them, they're going to have the 12-foot clearance that we're going to need for these buses. And they're, rather than having, you know, that kind of cut-through look a lot of times that you see along streets, side streets?
Sure.
Yeah, there you go. So we won't have that. We're going to have that beautiful canopy feel like when you're going down Rice Boulevard. So if you know the feel of driving down Rice Boulevard, we want to be able to have that type of feel when you're in our dedicated bus lanes going through this canopy of beautiful live oaks. So we're working on all that. And everything, I hope you understand, everything that I'm discussing is up for discussion. And until you see it planted or built, you know? But those are the goals and the hopes and plans. Here again is a rendering of what, again, this might look like. This is a later rendering. I think the beauty is, as you look at this, that every person in Uptown is a beautiful person. And I love that, especially even the dog. I look at the dog, even the dog is a beautiful dog. Because they are having people. This is a southbound look, looking down the boulevard as well. You kind of get the look and the feel. People have asked, what about those arches? What's going to happen to them? Design this to keep those arches. They have become ingrained in the identity of the area. So we're looking at how can we widen this boulevard and yet continue to utilize these arches. So we have the experts looking at that and saying, well, here's a great practical way that we could still maintain them on the boulevard and utilize them maybe for wayfinding stations or whatever. It's just, that's totally up in the air. But the plan is to keep them. We love them. Those signature standstill rings, all that. Plan is to keep that because it's very much branded in the identity of the area. A look at what it would look like in the evening, the lights. We really do want to create this great street energy, bring people out to the streets, bring them up and down, and give them a great place to live and work and shop. Here's some of the dedicated bus lanes. Again, all this is up for revision. Nothing's been finalized, but here's what we're talking about. First of all, the bus stations along the Post Oak Boulevard, you're looking at existing signaling that's already there, none of that's going to go away, and then additional signaling down on the south end at Fairdale, up on the north end where that new BHB tower is being built. We're going to need that. And then there's existing meeting openings that will have to be closed if we have these dedicated bus lanes in the middle of Post Oak Boulevard. So these medians here that are unprotected are going to have to be closed. So that is the design as of right now about where those stations are going to be. When we look at the level of service, or the LOS, we're looking at a variety of things. And as for example, if you look at Post Oak Boulevard at Richmond Avenue, we look at the year 2018. If there's a no build and a build, what are we looking at? Well, the grading is going to be like going to grade school, pretty much. If you see an F, it's not good. But you've got a delay for these vehicles at the PM peak hour on Post Oak Boulevard at Richmond of about 98.5 seconds. That's the delay. If we do nothing, that's what it's going to be. If we do something, it's going to help. It's still an F, but it will move to a 90. So you can have an 8% change in delay. As you look at 2035 and what's being projected for it, it actually is a greater change in delay of 16%. You go to Westheimer, Post Oak Boulevard, Westheimer was a major intersection, as you know. Again, if we are able to, when we build this, you can have a 20% change in delay. We're going to increase it that much, or better it that much. But then by 2035, that is going to better it even by 34%. And you can go down some of these highlighted ones, or if you're more interested in some of these other cross streets, you can look at the numbers for them. We are really working at, here's San Felipe and Post Oak, 2035, that's a 43% betterment. You got Uptown Park Boulevard, where Uptown Park is, 50% betterment. So we're looking at trying to really create a greater level of service as best we can for mobility in that area. What that means is it translates to this. Even if you include the dwell times of loading and unloading passengers, if you take Richmond to 610 at the peak hour right now, it'll take you 17 minutes in automobile. If you take this dedicated bus lane, it will take you 12 minutes. So it'll save you 5 minutes. And that even includes that dwell time of those dedicated buses. When you take transit center to transit center, that south anchor that's yet to be built and that north anchor that's there, the Northwest Transit, you're looking at a savings time between driving it in an automobile, 33 minutes, to driving it on the dedicated bus lanes in 19 minutes. It's a great savings. When you look at ridership, daily ridership, 2018, 2035, if we build Post Oak Boulevard and have that DBL with the Northwest Transit Center and the Bel Air Uptown Transit Center on the south end, 2018, what we're looking at is about 14,000 daily riders. By 35, 20,000 daily riders. These are the numbers that these traffic people are coming back to us with. Now, that does not include the 610 loop elevated lane. If we're able to add the elevated lane on the 610 loop with this I-610 dedicated bus lane, then those numbers are on steroids. And they increase. Those are some great significant numbers. Even this is a great number. And so even without, if for whatever reason, the dedicated on the 610 loop does not happen, it still shows that we can make a significant impact to the ridership along Post Oak Boulevard. But if it is, then those numbers increase. They kind of kick up on steroid, 19,000, and then 35. The projection is almost 28,000. When you look at the results of the sensitivity test, you've got kind of the same types of numbers as you can see. If you've got standard forecasts, and if you take redevelopment forecasts, and let me explain that. Redevelopment forecast is kind of our own local number. That's us kind of having local knowledge of what developers and owners and all that are talking about, discussing. And so if we do those numbers, we have different numbers than your standardized types of statistics. And again, it kicks it up more. So the need is there. All you have to do is drive it. You know the need is there. When we're looking at the ridership on these dedicated bus lanes, bus lanes at the maximum load points. And so if you take in the AM hour or the PM hour, those two peak hours, and if you're saying, say you're going southbound from the Northwest Transit Center, or you're going northbound at Westheimer, so you're moving up and down the boulevard, you can see what the changes and differences are in both 2018 and 2035. And then, of course, going home traffic as well, when we're moving people out of the area, you go northbound up to the Northwest Transit, southbound at Westheimer. Equivalent number of automobile lanes. Let's see, what time is it? I'll make sure we're on time. It's like adding an extra automobile lane without, and doubling, as it says, doubling the effective person carrying capacity of that boulevard without having to double the amount of space that it takes up. This is one of the suggested areas for this transit center down south. We've been meeting with the Bel Air City Council and have presented them several options. One option is the one that you're looking at. Another option, where this transit center is all in the city of Houston city limits. One where it's configured differently but still in both. And then one where it's just in the Bel Air city limits. And they are looking at some of those options and trying to determine what their thoughts are about the exact location of that transit center. This is just an early rendering of what that might look like. And obviously, this also includes some small retail shops and even a residential development here. What is the projected schedule? Right now, as far as urban design, we're working on it, and we're almost done with it. Final design will continue on throughout to the end of this year. And then as far as construction is concerned, we hope to begin construction in January 2015. We've got a right-of-way acquisition process we're going through right now, so we're talking to various owners. Lots of the landowners up and down the boulevard are on the board, so they've been well aware of this for years and years, actually. And then the other individual owners along the boulevard we've been in contact with, and we have a team that has been assigned to go discuss the right-of-way acquisition with them. And then construction, you know, we'd love for this to be done by the Super Bowl 2017. And we were hoping to begin construction January of this year, but we've had complications and setbacks and delays that we've had to wait on. And so now we're having to push that construction schedule. And so right now we're looking at mid-17. It could be, maybe, we hope, we would at least have the boulevard done, trees planted, flowers planted, place looking beautiful, maybe not the transit operating at that moment, but at least that done by the Super Bowl. That's kind of the goal. Preliminary cost estimates. If you were there at the town hall meeting on Monday, you saw Andy give this. By the way, this last half of all this is exactly what Andy Ethington gave to the town hall meeting, so I haven't changed anything. Uptown is putting in a little over $105 million of their own money on this. I say their own money, it's city money. It's from the TURBs, but it's the money that's dedicated into our area, our boundaries. TxDOT just committed last week $25 million. We were very fortunate and able to secure a federal grant from HGAC of almost $62 million. So we're looking at the total here, about $192 million, so say about $200 million. Obviously, the longer we're into this process, the higher those land prices have been getting lately. Have you all noticed that? And so we keep having to remodify our budget to this. Every month we have to wait. So right now, let's say about 200 a week. Here's the project status. We have environmental clearance from the feds. It's done. We have our letter of no prejudice. We can start spending money and get reimbursed. We've got preliminary designs have already been submitted to the city and the report to Metro. As you can see, status, you know, we're prepared to award the final design plans, contracts. We're ready for the right-of-way acquisition and all that. And there may be some changes along that way that I'm aware of. But those are the two options we're looking at right now.
That's inside the loop, though, right?
No, ma'am, that's outside the loop.
Well, we're straggling the loop on both sides. Northbound will go on inside the loop, and southbound will be outside the loop.
Okay.
If the feeder road, if 610 is the loop.
If, yeah. I have not seen plans to move those buses inside the loop. if it's going back up north. I'm assuming from those, is that what you were saying?
The service plan currently proposing is once you get on Post Oak and 610, if the elevated bus lanes are not in existence, then we use the frontage roads on both sides.
Oh, both sides, okay. Well, I haven't seen that, so, okay.
And then we get on Post Oak Road to get to the Northwest Transit Tower.
And then say again?
And on Post Oak Road to get to
Right.
So then the buses would be interacting with traffic?
Yes, sir. Then they would be, which is why we are working very hard with TxDOT to make sure that we're able to do the elevated, dedicated bus lanes on the 610 loop. And it could be that as far as timing, that we're going to have to use that alternative route while that's being built and until it's completed. Then once it's completed, then use those. That is the goal, though. Yes, sir.
Do you know if the overpass that the TxDOT would be working on would be designed with slopes and structure to support future LRT and a conversion from BRT to LRT, or is it going to be designed for BRT only?
The word from TxDOT is it's designed for BRT only. Yes, ma'am.
Post Oak has had a severe drainage problem for many years. Mm-hmm. I've not heard you address any improvements to drainage in this area on the system. What improvements will there be?
Okay, she asked, what improvements to drainage will there be? I'm going to have you contact Robert Tobby, our engineer. You know Robert. You met him on the tour, right? You did? He's the guy that will know the specific answers to your questions because he's well aware of drainage. Not on this one. No, ma'am. But I'll be happy to get you in contact with Mr. Tobby.
Robert is planning improvements in the...
On the drainage. And I know he is, but I don't know how specific your questions are, so you can ask him and he'll give you the details. Yes.
I have a couple of comments. And one
sure.
About trees. I've had this argument with John for a long time, but John doesn't like to put trees at the curb or at the edge there because they cost too much. Mm-hmm. But if a car hits them and destroys them and so forth, he's okay with what engineers call soft objects if the car hits a person.
Well, he's not okay that they hit a person.
So it's a very dangerous situation to not have something. If you have parking, that works.
Right.
But if you don't have parking, then we've got to be trees or bollards or something to put along there so cars don't leap up into the sidewalk.
Right.
Which happens pretty regularly where you have that situation.
Right. So we have bollards now. And as far as I know, the designs show bollards being used for those types of critical areas.
Okay. And then the other question, a lot of people live in Montrose will appreciate this, I think, was the live oaks. You know, in 10 years, those sidewalk pieces will be 6 inches apart from each other. They'll all be up in the air. You won't be able to walk on them. Why would you do that again?
Okay. There was several lively discussions about what types of trees and whatnot to put along the boulevard. And live oaks won out, and you're going to have to know the details of that. I can get you in touch with like James Vick from SWA, or you can talk to John himself to find out exactly why was the live oak chosen over other options. So I actually was not in on those discussions.
Then my final thing is about this DBL thing. It's pretty interesting. So. One of my questions is, why aren't you calling it BRT, which everybody else calls it? And the other one is,
right.
Why wouldn't you say dedicated transit lane?
Okay.
I know, and maybe the answer to that is you would be afraid it would look like you're trying to sneak something in there that the Congressman Colton doesn't want. Maybe that's the whole answer.
Did you hear his answer?
That might be it.
I'll just leave it at that.
The record reflects that as David Crosley.
Let the record show
that, why not
that Mr. Crosley answered his own question.
Why not the BRT? What's
well, I'm fine with calling it BRT.
Oh, okay.
It's a bus rapid transit system. I mean, that's what it is. It is a bus that is designed to operate like light rail. We want to be able to have 5-minute headways during peak hours. 5-minute headways. LRT system in downtown is at six-minute headways.
Maybe seven.
And maybe seven, right?
Six.
All right, so six. Help me out with some of the technicals. since Rod, you know, abandoned me. But we're looking at 5-minute headways for this system, and we want it to operate, we want it to be comfortable, convenient, reliable, consistent. We want people to know that they can, if they come in on, you know, if they're in Sugar Land and they're taking a Park and Ride Express, let's use them as an example. They're taking a Park and Ride Express, they go park the car, they get on the bus. They get on this bus, they take it into the South Transit Center that we're going to be building. They get off into air-conditioned comfort, they're going down an escalator, staying in air-conditioned comfort, and they don't have to wait, if they just missed it, they don't have to wait more than 5 minutes for the next BRT that's going to come by and pick them up and move them into the Uptown area. Okay? At lunchtime, you're working in the Williams Tower, and you want to go up north to Uptown to go to McCormick and Schmick, and no one's paying me anything for, you know, name recognition. These are just examples. How nice for them to be able to get out, okay, of their tower, walk, get on this BRT system, take it up. They don't have to get in their car, so they don't have to worry about, am I going to be able to, if they don't have a reserved parking space, they don't have to say, I don't know if I'm going to be able to find a parking space when I come back. I don't know where it's going to be if I come back. I don't have to try to find one there where I'm wanting to go, et cetera, et cetera. They just get on this. It keeps the car off the street. It allows them to move, you know, a mile and a half up the road or a mile up the road, go eat lunch, and then they come back, and they can trust that within no later than 5 minutes, it's going to come. There's going to be another BRT come by. They're going to be able to get on it. It's platform loading and unloading, so it's convenient. They get on it. They ride it back down to Williams Tower, get back into their office, and they can trust this, that it is a quality, comfortable, beautiful people mover. And that's
free.
Well, all right. Okay, do me a favor. Can you answer that question too? All right, here's the answer. Here's the answer. He asked, can it be free? And the answer is yes, no, and maybe. So here's how that works. Here's the short of it. To get into the area, if you're taking a parking ride, when you're at those two transit centers, there's going to be fare collection at those transit centers. Okay? So, at least as of right now, that's what the plan is as far as Metro, because Metro is going to own and operate those buses. Uptown is not. The city is not. Metro is. So, yeah, fare collection's there. Once you get into the zone, our hope is that it is a fare-free zone. To where we don't have to build, construct, maintain, operate, or enforce collection of fare within the zone. Okay? Not collection of fare, collection of fare within the zone. And the reason for that is, the numbers that we've gotten back from the people that know, is it would cost more money to collect fare than it would be to not. In other words, we'll lose more money collecting fare, then we'll lose money not collecting fare. And how convenient would it be for me to be able to, and as far as dwell times, as far as, I mean, when you think about all that, now here's the rub in this, okay? The rub in that is we have federal grant money, and there is a Title VI, and Title VI is going to say, why is it that you are offering free fare in a particular area of your city that is a very high economic area, and yet you're not offering fare free travel in other parts of the city that don't have the economic advantage. And that's a difficulty that we're having to look at and say, how can we do that? So you know, our hope would be that we could do that. My hope, I'm not speaking officially for Uptown now. I'm telling you my hope is that it could be a fare-free zone, because it would be great in a number of ways, economically, practically, and just as far as amenity-wise. But that's me speaking, okay? So they're looking into all that, but not sure if that's going to be an option. Steve?
My question may help you with that last issue, by the
good.
Way.
But,
you know, Post Uptown has a lot of, you're obviously very focused on handling the office worker crowd that's coming in on the park and rides, which is understandable, should be the top target. You also have a lot of other workers in Uptown who work at retail stores, hotels, etc., who are a very different kind of worker, probably much lower wage, maybe frankly low income, and maybe using other types of, not the park and rides, but the local transit to be accessing. How are you coordinating this with their needs?
Okay, that's a great question. That is being coordinated. The preliminary numbers that we have back, are you working with Ramesh? Is that where you're from? Or
me?
Yes. You guys seem to know a lot about.
I work for Metro.
Oh, you work for Metro. Okay, no. So you may know this too if you're working with Metro.
And I work on the project with
Okay.
Yes.
So if I say anything that's wrong, let me know, okay? Right now, Steve, it looks like the projection is a little over 50% of the riders on this BRT are projected to come up off a park and ride, but about, I'm trying to remember the numbers, I've read so many, that 25, 30% of them are going to be transferred coming off of Metro City bus rides, and then the rest are going to be either just within the zone, people like going out to either go to lunch, or some people may go out and use it to go to a meeting that they're having at some other office complex or whatnot. Primarily, we're utilizing this for office employment needs, the transit and mobility, because that's what's really crunching it up. But we want to be able to service everyone else, and so those workers that are working in the retail shops, those workers that are working in the hotels, and those workers that, as you mentioned, we're going to have a significant amount, we believe, they're going to be utilizing it as well. So that may be, you know, something that we can put into the mix as we continue to look at, is it possible for us, not just economically, but legally, to be able to do that? Good point. The lady right behind you.
To comment on that also, because y'all know me, bus lady, that at one of the meetings, they talked about riders like me, use the day pass, which you only pay a maximum of $3 per day, so it wouldn't cost your local transferees anything extra, because when you tap your day pass, you tap it once, $1.25, you tap it twice, $1.25. The third one is 50 cents, and the more you ride it, it's like it's free the rest of the day. Mm-hmm. So in that aspect, that would help with figuring out. I was at the Metro meeting the other day about that, and they said, oh, they use a day pass.
Okay.
That'll work also, because they had I know it's a sticking point about the
charge. Yeah, but I mean, those discussions are still in play. You know, I mean, they're still being discussed. How can this best serve the city of Houston and its citizens? That's the bottom line. You know, that's where we're trying to go with all this. Mm-hmm. Yes, sir.
Will there be stops on the northern section of this at Woodway and or Memorial?
As of right now, I have not seen any plan that shows stops there, but I know that there's talk about how, if it's possible, to service that area so that we can help people get in and out of the Memorial Park area. But boy, there's a lot of, Sarah Newberry, who's a project director for that, I don't know if you know, but you know, the city of Houston has now extended the length of our TERS to 2040, and has expanded our boundaries to include Memorial Park. And so now, after we're able to rebuild Post Oak Boulevard, we're going to have dollars, TERS dollars, that we're going to be able to kind of focus on the restoration and the preservation of the park. And while we're doing that, we're looking at how can we, because we have this opportunity, how can we make sure that that park is a beautiful amenity for the city of Houston. And so we're spending a lot of time right now with the contract design team from New York that is working on how can we make this area maintain its beauty and its almost in some ways contemplative, its educational perspective for the city. How can we take this park and still allow the activity that's involved in it, like the running and all that? How can we maintain that, still also maintain its kind of its untouched beauty, and yet allow better ingress egress into the area? So all that's been discussed now. I wish I had an answer for you.
Let me help you, Bob, a little bit.
Okay.
Metro is going to plan, or is going to design the service plan for this. As you know, Metro Metro Service and server run the, operate the service here. So we'll be coming up with a service plan. Currently, we do have a stop at a stop, not a station, like these Post Oak Boulevard ones that you saw, but we would want to stop at Memorial Station. There is a potential stop that we're proposing there. Where as long as we're on the frontage routes, once the elevated bus lanes kick in, then you know that station will have, that stop will have to go away. That's
okay.
Yeah.
Is there a plan to link the South Transit Center to the Bel Air Transit Center?
Yes.
South Transit Center.
Oh.
Yeah.
The Bel Air Transit Center to the Bel Air Uptown Transit Center.
Okay.
Yes.
Yes, sir.
Two questions. How the bus is going to be powered?
Again, these are metro owned and operated. I know they're looking at a variety of options. You may know better about what
still
it's going
looking
to be.
At
we're still looking at most likely there would be diesel power or clean diesel vehicles.
Wants to be a bus driver, that's what I would say.
Sorry. We're also looking at electric buses. So.
Yeah, technology, you know, the technology for transportation and what fuels it changes all the time, so.
Yes.
My other question is, you were saying you're going 11 feet on each side to widen from, I guess, Denver Stern, how wide the boulevard is. When you take your land, and well,
six,
land?
16 feet total. And we are going to be taking, there's going to be some right-of-way acquisition in that. And as we go up and down the boulevard, that's a general. Because when we go up and down the boulevard, there's certain spots that it's just impossible to take that much. And so there'll be those pinch points and whatnot. But that's generally what's going to happen on the boulevard.
So no serious impact or some serious impact or somewhere between on the street parking that exists now?
There's no on the street parking on Pleasant Boulevard.
Joe Blow goes over there to I-Fly.
Are you talking about in the retail, in retail places?
Yeah. Now there's so many missing feet, which is so many missing parking places.
Okay. Yeah, we're discussing with all the landowners up and down, especially with the retail, and what it's going to take. There'll be some, gosh, there's a variety of answers to that. One is for some, there's no impact to the parking. For some, there is impact to their parking. For some who have parking impacted, they say, we got plenty of room, we can restripe in such a way that we probably won't lose 3-4 parking spaces. It's different for each one up and down the boulevard, and again, those discussions are going on right now. We're well aware of the need for parking in the area. Parking is a huge issue for us, just as much as transit is. And not just for retail, but residential has to provide their own parking. You got offices that, some of these offices that were built back in the late 70s, early 80s, they were built with 2,500 to 1,000 parking, and the needs now are more like a 5,000 parking. So we're aware of the parking issues, and we're trying to deal with those as we design this boulevard. Yes, ma'am.
Well, just to line those lines, I would think a lot of that surface parking in the future is going to go away anyway, because I would think it would all be redeveloped with, you know, garage parking or something maybe behind the buildings, because it just seems like that land's going to be so expensive to be surface parking.
And see, of course, that's the decision of the landowner, because that's their land. So that's what we see, though. We see with a lot of these places that have 1 to 2 story, whether it's condominiums or retail or whatever, we can see where the land prices are going to become so valuable that they will first want to redevelop it. When they redevelop it, they're going to go higher and more dense. And when they do, they're going to have to provide more parking garage type space rather than surface parking. But that's their decision.
I didn't really pay attention to the drawings. I think they assume there's cafes and retail right there on Post Oak Boulevard, not parking lots, because nobody's going to walk on the street. It's just parking lots, right? So
right.
It assumes redevelopment and that stuff goes away.
Right. The trend right now, obviously, especially in the area, is, and we think it's going to become even more so once we have this grand boulevard, is that these retail shops like the container store shop, mm-hmm. You got 15 acres there. Kevin Miller's owner of that. He's the chairman of the board of Uptown District. You know, that's, boy, that's valuable land, and for him to keep it the way it is, we don't see that happening, but that's his decision. So we think once the boulevard's built, that there'll be a lot of people that will want to design higher density, move those buildings closer to these, this beautiful sidewalk area, and then provide parking in the back or whatever. That's their decision.
On the 136-foot wide right-of-way, is that continuous from the loop all the way south to Richmond?
Yes, with those exceptions where it's just impossible to get that much.
What happens south of West Conner to the beautiful big oak trees that obviously are going to have to go? Are they going to be try to be preserved, or is it just not feasible?
South of West Conner on the west side?
Both sides.
I will tell, yes, and it's a great question. We are preserving as many oak trees as we can. We are preserving as much of the landscape and as many trees as we can that are currently there. We may have to move some. We may have to remove some while we build and then replace. But we're trying to save as many of the trees as we can. There's a guy named Rob Burke that's working on the whole tree thing. And the latest numbers I've heard from him, okay, and this was like a couple of weeks ago, latest numbers I heard from him was that as far as that particular area that you're talking about, it looks like we may have to lose about two of those trees.
We'll lose more than that.
Well, how far down south are you moving from?
Two blocks south of West Tower, between the Macy's,
Dillard's
Marcus and Dillard's, that stretch. They're big trees down the middle and on either side.
Huge trees. Oh, okay. I haven't looked on the east side. I sat down with him to talk about the west side because of a particular need I wanted to discuss with someone. I can tell you on the west side, they're looking at about two trees, but then they're going to come back and plant three times as many.
Small.
No.
They can't be the size of what's there.
Believe it or not, I think they're looking at like an 8-inch caliper tree that they're going to replant.
Yeah, those are 60-foot tall trees.
It depends on how.
Take a look the next time you go.
Well, I'll have to take a look. Because
I spent about $80,000 to move one.
They've looked at all that. I'm not in the tree business, so I haven't looked at the details of that, but I trust the people that have done that. If you want more details, I'd be happy to give you Rob Burke's.
One other question, Alex, is that when we go side, the whole loop will have to be completely transcendental both in before somebody's got a bus running. Is that right?
Along the boulevard?
Yeah.
A dedicated bus.
You have to have some place to turn around, so somewhere. The whole thing will be finished before the first bus runs?
Yes.
Transit center?
Yes. Yeah, as far as I know. If I'm understanding your question right, Andrew.
Bob, I'm not living in this area. I'd love to. Can't afford it. If I'm coming in from South Post Oak, South Loop, I want to come up and down. Is there going to be parking there at the Bel Air Transit Center so I can park there? And then get to hop on off and have fun and get my car and more UPS.
Right now, preliminary plans show what, about 700 parking spaces?
Yes. Oh, great. Okay.
Yeah.
Wonderful.
Yeah. I don't know. I have to answer.
Thank you.
Yes.
So, very exciting stuff. Thanks.
Thank you. I appreciate you.